Recording. The other day, we work on the flows that I'm showing on the screen. We test the different triggers and we use some templates to test the flows. Today, I want to talk about the licensing model, what are the things that it includes and the limitation when to consider a premium, when to not. And the other thing that I want to do today is a flow that includes multiple basic actions, like variables, a condition, maybe a loop if there is time for that. But let's start with licensing model. This is very confusing because before we start talking about licensing model, we want to understand what is a premium action and what not. So I will just open the pricing for here. But let's go back to Power Automate while this page loads. Okay, let me open here. A premium action is very easy to distinguish. If you click here, there is a category literally that says premium. You can click there. And also you can see that this action has this green box that says premium. So what it means is that if you see other actions here that don't have the green box premium, it means you can use all of these actions with the default version, the normal version. So you don't need to do any extra payment to execute these apps. And for most of the scenarios, that's more than enough. There are certain situations where the premium could be important. Let's say when you want to integrate with some tools or some big systems that only exist in the premium connector. Let's see, for example, the Azure connectors, premium. What else? SQL connectors are premium. Dynamics, premium. And there are also third-party software. I'm not sure if this one is premium. Yep, this is premium. Let's see SAP. SAP is premium. So as you can see, premium are actions of systems that normally are at user sorry at used in bigger companies or medium or large business, not so much in a small business. So for many situations, you have all you need with the standard actions. Only when you are working with another company that has platforms like those, the premium connector is useful. And also the pricing will become relative in terms of the value they gain because of the facilities or the easy the way you make easier their work. So probably it's going to be less complicated to get premium license for a company like that. It's more easy to justify the value. However, with a small company, it's more difficult to justify that they need to invest in premium. There is still one situation that could be very useful for a small business. This connector, Word for Business, this one. Populate a Microsoft Word template. Okay, let me tell you, from a long time ago, with workflows, it was possible to create documents automatically for SharePoint. And that thing remained true for many years. And as an alternative, you can do documents with other actions like the HTML or PDF maker, no, OneDrive, convert file. This convert file allows you to convert an HTML file. That means you can create an HTML string, save it as an .html file, and then convert to a PDF with this action. That's, let's say, the free approach. But you need to know how to assemble HTML files. If you need to update the template, you need to modify the code that you use to create that HTML file. It requires some skills. You need to have experience for that. So a normal users will have a hard time using this approach. In the other hand, when you use Word populate a Word template, okay, this option allows you to select an existing Word template, and there you can specify some fields to fill the information inside the document. It supports a single line of text, multi-line, dates, numbers, even repetitive sections like tables with multiple rows or growing tables. It can have one row, two rows, three rows. You can do that with this connector too. So it's very, very, very useful. The only thing, you need to pay for the premium connector. So, but just this thing by itself can be enough to justify the purchase of a premium connector for a small business, because there is many small business that work a lot with documents. Imagine this person is a lawyer, or maybe a doctor with a lot of patients, or probably an HR department of a company, or a small company, maybe 5 people, but they do a lot of sales with a lot of documents. So this will be very important for them. Another action that is not necessarily depending on if it's small or big or whatever is the HTTP action, HTTP request. This one, come on. Okay, this HTTP allows you to call APIs. So if there is another system for which the connector doesn't exist, okay, let's imagine I want to connect with TikTok, and I look TikTok here, and the app is not, the connector, it doesn't exist. Well, but if you have the API for TikTok, you could use the HTTP. Oh, come on. Okay, and when it opens, it asks for the address, the protocol, if you want to do a post, the query parameters for the call, the tokens, all of that stuff to execute API, you can do it with this action. So just with this action alone, you multiply the possibilities. You have endless possibilities to connect with any system that has an API. So for any type of business that require an integration like that, just this small thing will justify and pay itself when getting a premium connector. Okay, so now that we know that premium connector are the same things like the actions we put here, with the difference that they have a different category to tell you need to pay for them, we know it's a little easier to distinguish when you need premium and when not. Okay, so apart from that, there might be other stuff to get premium, but it's mostly about connectors. When you need to take a decision, almost every time the question is about the connectors. Okay, so let's see what we have. We have these two types, or two main, actually one. This one, the $15 is the most common for a standard situation. You need this to get premium. There is no previous to premium because the standard is already included in the Office 365 license. There is a free version of Power Automate. So before premium, there is nothing. It's just the standard plan, the normal plan. So when you need to pay for Power Apps by itself, you start with premium right away. This is premium already. So what are all the other stuff? Well, it's mostly for different things. For example, this one that says RPA is Robotic Process Automation, which is another type of Power Automate, not the common flows that we saw before. It's not for this, not for this, not for this. Robotic Process Automation is for desktop flow. This one. This allows you to record some manual steps with your pointer, your mouse, and your keyboard. You do some actions, you record those actions with a flow, and then you can execute them. And that's the cost of that kind of process. In the other hand, we have the per flow plan. This is more similar to this one because we are talking about the same type of flows. The difference is on this one, you are basically saying, hey, the user that has this plan can execute any amount of flows. All the flows that person wants to execute will be able to, no problem. But with the one here, you are not talking about the user. You are saying the specific flow can be executed by any user, regardless the license the other users have. If you put this license to a specific flow, any person can execute it, even if they don't have a premium plan. So when this will be good and when this will be good? Most of the cases, this one, for sure. But imagine you have a very important flow and the users that will execute are a lot. So let's say 500 divided by 15, 33. Let's say you have 14 people or 50 people, you want to use that flow. If you want to purchase license for each one of them, it will be higher than this. And the other thing is, that's the only flow you want to execute. Maybe there is no second flow or third flow, at least not with a premium action. So it is most cost effective to go this path. But imagine you have, for the same number of people, you have two flows or three flows with premium connectors, then this no longer makes sense. It's going to be better to purchase this thing. So it's very easy to jump from one to the other in terms of convenience. So for most of the scenarios, I say try to go with this path because it gives you more flexibility and you can grow. You can have more flows later with premium actions. This one will be better. Let's see if there is another information here at the bottom. Okay, so it's not only about being able to use premium connectors or not. There are a few extra things here that we need to consider. So to start with, this thing in the middle has some extra considerations that we need to take in account, because it's mostly for this robotic process automation, the desktop flow. So therefore, what they are doing here is give you details for that specific type of execution. The details below apply for the three cases. Oh, sorry. Okay, so these rows here apply for this, and this. It means you can use the standard connector for all of these. You can use custom and other connectors, on-premise connectors with this, and this. And also it says you can manage custom entities with three. And also they give you access to the Dataverse or the common data service by giving you some storage capacity. This one is also included with PowerApps licensing. And is an intersection point that you need to analyze when deciding whether to go for a premium in PowerApps or a premium in Flows. This and also another factor will be the scope of those flows or that PowerApp. If you plan to do more flows with premium, then maybe this is better. If you need premium in Power Apps, then the only way to do that is to get the premium in Power Apps. But in what regard to Power Automate alone, these are the things to consider. Another thing is the maximum executions that you have, but I want to see where that is. I think it's here. Let's see. Yep. No, API request. That's another thing. Runs. Where are the runs? Okay. API requests. This is not the same as runs, but it follows a similar logic. You have different amount of rows depending on the of the plan that you purchase. So you can expect there will be very few runs for free plans or the normal or standard license, and there will be more runs for the premium or the other variation of license. But I don't see the runs detail here. Runs, where is runs? cannot find the wrong detail. Maybe they removed that, but that would be very weird. There is a comment here. That this is curious because this says user to run unlimited flows, which that's new for me. And the other contradictory thing is this message, this text that says you can buy additional data storage, file storage, and flow runs. So that means they sell this separate too. So if they were limited, why should you purchase this separately? Previously, there was a list very easy to see right here in this table. I don't know why that information is no longer here. Let's see if we find it in the licensing guide. How curious. It seems they have removed that. Okay, this one says create unlimited flows, but that doesn't mean run. Create unlimited. Okay, I think they have changed the limitations. Before it says here runs, but now says API request, which is not the same as an execution. So first we need to define API request. So what is the scope of an API request? Let's see. Is there more information? No. All of this is talking about API request. Huh, look at that. That's very curious. Request. Okay. Okay, here it says, what is a request? All API requests to connectors, HTTP actions, built-in actions. Holy moly, this looks worse than before. Because a run was a full execution of a flow. But API request it this sounds like every single action. Okay, but as a pro, it seems the limit is per day.
This limit is for single user or concrete user licensing?
It's very not funny, also not nice to spend the time with, but important to do from time to time. Otherwise, it will happen like today with me, because I was still thinking on the previous model of runs. And now they switch it to API request. So interesting information, certainly important. Okay, so should we be concerned or not? I will say not that much, because it's very, very unlikely that you run out of those executions in a normal consumption. You must be doing very extreme things like flows that repeat a lot, or flows that trigger other flows and in chain. Maybe a single user action causes the trigger of 10 or more flows, and you have 20 users doing the same one day. Probably you could have problems with the capacity. But I say it is very, very unlikely. I have not seen a case with a normal business execution to run out of executions. So it's mostly, it can happen though, if you are developing flows and you have a loop action that triggers the flow itself again and again and again and again. So a flow that doesn't have the proper validations to prevent to trigger itself, that can happen. And if you are developing and you don't put attention to those scenarios, that will burn all your executions. There was another place where you could look at the at the total that you had, but I don't see it. Nope. Okay, here you can monitor activity in total. I guess the other page to see the progress, it was like a bar that has some numbers that says you have consumed 1,000 runs and you have 100,000 left. Maybe because they switched the billing method for executions is the reason why we don't see that bar anymore. But I cannot confirm until we can further research about that. Okay, so licensing and that stuff is a topic that is never going to end. Something is always changing with license, and you need to also analyze each circumstance, because one decision you take one day might not be the same for another scenario. for every situation that you face, you need to analyze and say, what is more convenient for this specific customer? What is more convenient for this specific project? And compare all the options.
Right.
The only advice I can give in that regard is try to look for the licensing guide from time to time, and especially before important projects. Do not start a project that will require premium things without checking the licensing, just to see if anything has changed. Okay, so that's it for the licensing. I believe we are going to talk a little bit about Power Apps licensing too later. We have covered some of it already, so I don't think we need to repeat a lot of things, but later we are going to refresh some of it and discuss important additional details, especially to do the intersection with Power Automate and Power App, and when to take decision for one or the other, because both have premium license, and it is important to be able to recognize the situation, when to go for one or when to go for the other. It's not just about the interface, because if you have a Power Apps premium license, you can also execute premium connectors in Power App Automate. It's more complex than that. Okay, so that's the reason we need to discuss this further. Well, there is one more thing that I need to tell you about licensing, and it's not going to be necessarily related with how Microsoft do this or in the runs and that stuff. It's more related about the trigger type. If you remember, we have these five type of flows, but mainly for the purposes we are reviewing are these three. This one, Automate, expects something to execute in the data source. Once that action execute in the data source, this flow will run with the credentials of the people that, of the person that created the flow, the author of the flow. This one, the instant flow, requires a manual action from the user. When the user clicks or executes the flow, the full flow will run with the credentials of the person that did the click, the user that did the interaction, not the author of the flow. Schedule is similar as automated because there is no manual action happening here. This is just execute from time to time, so it will execute with the credentials of the creator of the flow. These two execute with the creator credentials, and this one in the middle with the person, the user credentials. Why that is important? Why this has anything to do with licensing? Well, it turns out that any person that has a direct interaction with your flow, let's say an instant flow, requires the premium connector too. That's very important. It's crucial to understand that, because imagine the following. You have a button in a SharePoint list or maybe in your phone that will trigger a manual triggered flow to create some contracts with a premium connector, with a Word template connector. And imagine you have 20 people in the company, 20 users. So every person that needs this flow requires the premium connector if you are going to use this trigger. However, if you do a small change and expect something to happen in a data source, maybe the manual trigger modifies a record in a list, and then with this second flow that is expecting the change in the list or the other data source, from this you execute your premium connectors. Only the account that created the flow requires the premium license. That's very interesting because you can save some budget with understanding how this thing work, what account executes the flow, and what license the account requires. We can see something more specific later, but for now, it's important to remember that something as small as that can have a tremendous impact on the required budget in terms of licensing. Okay, so that's all for the licensing topic today. Do you have any questions?
No, almost it's clear. Actually, license is required in bigger, we can say if we are creating crucials flow or side like connect with some other tools like SQL or add OneDrive, then I guess it's required. But in normal time, it's not required as usual.
But you will see that this situation that I commented at the end,
yes,
it will be common. The more you work with Power Automate, the more you will face this decision how to distribute the execution. Okay, so we don't have much time left, but let's try to do something. Let's do a manual trigger flow because this is funny and easy to test. We don't want to worry too much about the trigger, right? Instead, we want to see the actions below the trigger. So manual trigger. And this is, okay. Let's add some, okay. Let's put some input here first to do something with that input. Okay, so a text box. Let's call this text input one. And then text input two. How about this thing? And just know boolean input one. Then number input one. Number input two, maybe a date. What else? The email. Yeah, why not? Let's save an email. And finally, a file. Okay, maybe we are not going to test all of these values today, but some of them will help us to test the next actions. That's good enough for this flow. Let's add now variables. Variables, as well as any other system, help you to store temporal information to do calculations and then use them later in further actions. And the variables when working with variables, you need to consider two things. The moment where you create a variable, which is called the initialization, like this, and whenever you change the value of the variable, which is called set variable. Apart from that, there are other actions to update the data of variables, depending if they are arrays or other type of values, but they are basically the same thing. They are setting the value, updating the value. So if we reduce it, there is only two things. The moment when you create the value, initialize the variable, and the moment where you update the variable or set the variable. Okay, imagine this happens at the very beginning and before any decision, any calculation, and this will happen after, during some calculations, other things like that. Okay, so let's initialize a variable. What this will be, let's put the text together. This and this text. The name of this variable, I use terms like this. I like to put bar at the beginning to whenever I see this object in my code or in my logic or expressions later, I remember that it's something that I wrote. So bar is fine. And concat, no. Next to together. Yeah, I think it's like that. Or was forget it is together. Yeah. Okay. And it is going to be a string. Okay, so how we put text together with an expression, concat. And then, let me see if there's another one. It's just one. Text input, comma, and then text input 2, just like that. Let's make a test and see if that works. Hey, why is this required? I didn't set it as required. Okay, here are the inputs. Now let's take a look at what the variable did. So it put the text together. The only problem is it didn't add a space in between, because we didn't specify it. We just say, hey, merge this with this, and there is no space in between. Let's fix that. All we need to do is to add another string in between. The separation from one input from the other is the comma. So I need to put another comma here, and then inside single quotes, put space. If you hover, you can see the formula there. Actually, notice that it didn't save it my change. Let's click on it again. Yeah, it didn't. Sometimes it does that, so be careful. Always double check to confirm it has done your modification. Click update. Okay, and now it's updated. It's there. So don't trust on the first click. I'll always look again. Okay, this time it joined the text to correctly. Another thing. Okay. I can't click here. Okay. Optional. Okay. Now it should be, everything should be optional. What else? Well, this is not the only way to put text together. You see, the concat formula normally is when you need to do something else, not just join the text. There is an easier way. Delete this and literally type the values here. For example, select the text input from the dynamic panel here. Remember what I told the other day, that we should always look at this gray area. Come on. This gray area to see where these properties are coming from. In this case, they are being received from the manual trigger above. Okay, so let's look for the text input. Okay, it's there. And I can I type a space here? Space, and then text input two. And I can also type other stuff if I want. This is the output. It. There it is. It printed everything. So if is that easy, why to use complicated formulas like this? Because sometimes you need to. Sometimes the best way to do it is with expressions. It's not very simple to say, hey, every time you have this, use this approach. Every time you have this other situation, use the expression. It's more like an instinct you develop from the practice experience. But generally speaking, if you don't need to do any calculation or anything to contain the result of that concatenation, then you can simply put it directly in this box. Okay, well, actually, let's leave the text there. And let's add a new step. We're going to initialize another variable. Let's work with the Boolean and the numbers. Okay, this is very interesting. We're going to face a very interesting situation. Let's remove this one first. Let's ask for a question. Control, condition. If the Boolean, where is it? Boolean input equals expression true. If the Boolean is equal to true, then let's do the calculation. Let's put these two numbers together. Even better, if this is true, we do an addition. If this is false, we do a minus, decrease. So let's try to do it. It will say, okay, that's the first numeric variable I'm going to write. So because it doesn't exist, I will try to initialize it here. Oops, what it says here, the operation initialize variable can only be used at top level. It means out of your conditions, not inside these blocks or any other type of block that can contain other blocks inside. It means only in the area that is not inside any other block. But that's not the end of the road. We can still achieve what we want. The only situation is that we are going to initialize the variable above as an empty variable. It's going to be float, float. Number result. And it's going to be empty. I'm going to leave this empty. Now, here, I'm going to put my set variable from one calculation, set variable, and the other set here for the other calculation. Right? So let's pick number result. Number result. If this is true, then addition. And let's see, how about if we try to do this number input and then plus this. Let's try that. It looks weird, but it can happen. So let's try it. Okay, not sure about the one above, but these two are saying that the input value is wrong. It's not allowing even to save. This stuff is not good. Why? Because this is to type text. This is not really a mathematical operation. So if I write this thing here, what I'm doing is this text, the character plus, and this text, just as text, not as an operation. The same goes for here. This number, this character, this number. But the problem is this variable is expecting a number, not text. That's why it's throwing an error. So let's take out this. So how we do an addition then? Click on expression. It might seem too many characters for a simple thing, but that's how it works. So the function add number input, comma, not plus, comma, the second number. Same goes for here. Well, actually, not less. It's the same add, but with a negative. So the positive number will be input one, and then comma, minus this thing. Let's see if that works. No. Negative here. Minus what? I'm sure there is an easy way for this, but I cannot remember right now. I'm too tired. So I did it in the long, long way. A lot of stuff just for reduction. Okay. This thing we have seen already. We initialize the variable as empty value, and then we set, because the condition returns false, then we do this one on the right. Let's see. I put the same number, so the result is zero. Let's edit again and put something else. New data. Oh, interesting. This expression has failed because the string is empty. The input, the things to concatenate are empty. So we are facing now a situation where we need to start to consider error catching, or to at least make our formulas a little bit more complex to validate more stuff, not just trying to use the data assuming that it's not empty. Okay, we need to be careful with that stuff. But I'm going to teach you how to validate that situation later. Right now, the only thing I want to do is to see these two values working. So
if it has better, then I guess this issue will not come, right?
Can you say that again?
If all fields user have put values like text, first name, last name, or number one, number two, then might be this issue will be not occurs. This issue occur only we have missed, user have not entered all the values in that text box. Okay. That's when this issue comes.
Yes, but imagine this text input is first name and this is last name.
Right.
And you forgot one of them. Then it will break and it will fail. So you need to have a process to handle the scenario when any of
first we have violations means it is not empty, then that can give concatenate.
Exactly.
Right.
So let's put something for now, like Boolean, yes, 150, run flow, done. Okay, there it is. All right, this has been already good for today. We are not finished with the variables. We still need to do more things. like these validations that we discussed, like the empty or other things. We also need to work with arrays and other variable, other data types with the variables. This is a very, very important because basically if you understand variables, you can work very easy with almost any situation. Of course, there are other skills that you need to have. Maybe to know how to work with JSON, or how to work with APIs, or how to decompose multi-item results like tables or other things like that. But that's going to be a lot easier by having this knowledge. Understanding how the variables work is the foundation to everything else.
Can you set the default value in the initialize like a zero or something? If it is a numeric value, then at least we can get set zero values instead of empty.
Can you rephrase that?
We have initialized variable 1, variable 2, right? So can we set default value in the value point? Like if it is a numeric value, then at least 0 will be value there as a default value.
For example, imagine instead of these two being always true, probably none of these will be true. Mm-hmm. You can already have a default value here.
Yes, 0 value at least.
Mm-hmm. Or in the formula that you put here in the expression, you can you can do that calculation with a lot of ifs. If this, then do that. Because yes. You can put if too. So totally possible. And certainly we're going to do that something like that next time just to manage this error. By the way, let's put a comment to remind us that we need to fix this. And we click here, and then here add a comment. Add logic to support scenarios when the values are empty. Oops. No. Empty. Okay, that's how you add comments. Another good practice is to also rename these boxes. Certainly, when you work with variables, you are not going to refer to this box. But when you are initializing a lot of variables, it's going to be difficult to navigate and try to find which thing, where is each bar or other objects you are initializing. So let's rename this and put something like this. Bar put text to be number results. Like that. Okay. Sometimes it's also good to rename conditions, but not necessarily. Imagine you have a lot of conditions and you keep things collapsed like this. Maybe it would be wise to rename this. For example, all right, that's it. Any question or comment?
No, it's clear to till now.
All right, let's end for today. Thank you very much and have a very good day.
Thank you, same to you.
Bye.